There are very good reasons for C occupying a special place in the firmament of languages. Although I think the thing to say at the outset is really it finds its maximum power, its maximum raison d'etre for even existing at all, if you think of it as being the classical system implementation language. Again, for younger viewers, it's going to be hard to understand and comprehend this, but if you go back to the early mainframe era, you were getting really, really powerful computers, well, by those days standards, coming along in from the early 60s onwards. They were so expensive, they had to be time-shared between lots of users, and that in turn means you've got to have system software that can multitask between different people, different people's programs loaded into the machine at the same time, all being time-sliced with a little bit of time, but at the same time, increasingly, computer systems had to evolve into not just being able to print out your output and your answers, but to store it in a file. They had to run file systems. And by the early 1970s, you were in this incredible situation that one of the biggest challenges in programming, a real-time challenge where you had to keep people happy, was nothing more or less than the operating system in your computer. One of the hardest challenges going, and yet the wisdom was you will only ever be able to do this in assembler. Some of the low-level tricks you need to do in operating systems, you know, the real man attitude, real men use assembler. And I think a lot of people said no, there's some truth in that. But on the other hand, just a little bit of higher level operations, if only it could be done without slowing the language down too much, would help us stay sane. I think a lot of people gradually were, if you like, embellishing assemblers to become macro assemblers to try and give the kind of higher level approach to things that you got in high level languages. But on the other side, the opposing army was always saying, high level language, they're so inefficient. You need assembler for everything, ideally. Moore's law put paid to that, you know. Yes, we can afford to use high level languages for a lot more things. In the early 70s, then, there were a lot of experiments in trying to, usually to adapt existing languages for system implementation use, and particularly ones that had started to build in some low-level operations for bit twiddling. It was getting important to be able to dig down to the byte level and get out characters looming up just on the horizon. Shock horror, as if 16 bits wasn't a toy computer, 8 bits coming. So you needed a language to evolve that could cope with different width of objects. Of course, as it becomes, you go through a sort of, like a minimum in the curve, you know, we have to chop things down in size because otherwise we can't make it at a price that people will buy. But then as hardware becomes cheaper, generally, you then turn the corner, and you could see it even in DEC and their PDP-11 mini computers. Soon enough, they come along with a 32-bit computer, which they can afford to make at long last. And of course, that was the era when discrete transistors and components on printed circuit boards gave way to chip technology. So you had like LSI-11s, it's large-scale integration, it's not separate components anymore, and gradually the curve turns the other way.
How did this change in architecture feed back into the language choices then?
Well, I think that it, two things. First of all, can you get a system implementation language that helps you do low-level things at a higher level? And I still think that probably you could say the most successful of all time on that front was C. It's not that there weren't others. There were things like Bliss. There were things like even ALGOL 68 and other high-level languages. BCPL were tried out. But C had the great advantage that you could see how you might port it. Dennis Ken, all that. They're doing that on the PDP 11. They'll be doing it on the VAX. But up come the Suns, all of a sudden, the Sun servers. Hey, can we port Unix to this? We're porting Unix. We've got to get the C compiler working. Can you get the C compiler working? Yeah. Yes, of course you can. And it really stood the test of time. I mean, when you look now in the GCC compiler at the architectures that are supported, it just writes its own brochure saying, just look at this, we can cope with anything. However, the other side of that was that the differentiation to, if you like, higher level languages, even imperative ones, just became more marked. And I think it was very interesting that I think it was in the mid to late 80s, James Gosling of Sun, effectively, it's people who run programmers and see how many mistakes they make when they're using pointers. And as far as I recall it, one of the design requirements of Java was, we're gonna ban pointers at user level. When we start looking at why programs go wrong, it's people who've made mistakes with pointers, so therefore we're gonna ban them. And I'm actually not against that. If you really don't need to do low-level manipulations of pointers, then let the language do it for you. Or if it's like C++, where you could do them and you say, I don't want to do all my clever stuff under the hood, I'm not writing an operating system, yeah, get hold of a library full of functions and trust them, because they'll have been tested, they'll be efficient, and all this kind of thing. So, yes, things like functional languages, which of course always used to, still do, get flack for being so slow, they became more and more possible to do. They, I suppose Brian might say, they got less and less inefficient, you know. But no, it was a liberation to have that much compute power around that you didn't have to think too much. I'm glad that many sensible souls on the comment streams of recent videos have said this. It's no good getting theological about you're not a real programmer if you don't program in C or anything silly like that. You've got to have an attitude of horses for courses, the right programming language for the right task. If it's yelling out to use Python, use Python. If it's yelling out to use all, because I've been known to do, yeah, I tried out, as you know, my Reed and Muller messages from Mars. I got it, hacked it together in awk. Well, why not? You can always take the view that if it's not efficient enough, we can drive down to a lower level, more efficient language. But the ability to try things out without them taking hours and hours because of really fast hardware is probably about the biggest liberation I can think of in terms of my professional career as a computer scientist.
You know, I'm not a programmer. I mean, one day it might make a video, my bad exploration of BASIC in my youth. But as a non-programmer, I suppose I come at this and think, well, why can't there be one thing that fits all? And my kind of taking kind of examples from other parts of life, presumably certain things are good for certain things, like
yes,
you say.
I think that's right. I think that you see it in all sorts of other realms in life, is that, you know, the true professional tool for doing something, it was probably very different from a user level tool. You know, I mean, if you go to a hardware store and buy yourself a drill with a hammer action, you know, that's a very different object from what they would use industrially to hack into buildings. It's in principle the same, but the whole spec and construction of it is very different. And that's what we now have the ability to do, is to fit the language to the task. Of course, it still leaves a big problem that lots and lots of software ideally should have been rewritten years ago, because the moment you get something that's good for its time and works, the temptation is just to leave it in place because it works and we daren't change it because so many things are dependent on this. So this is why there are still 8-bit Z80 programs doing heaven knows what in the armed forces. There are probably still companies out there in the wild still using COBOL on mainframes. You know, cost of a mainframe simulation these days, peanuts. That program costs us a fortune to rewrite it, and it's bound to go wrong, and it's known and reliable. So that thing about having legacy software and hardware, and it's so difficult to trust to replacing it. It's still, it's going to be a problem eternally, I think, that.
Well, there is a well-known phrase, if it ain't broken, don't fix it.
What's helped the ain't broken bit, you see, that's the thing, is that if there's something rather exotic on the hardware front from the 1960s, you no longer have to literally build one of those. You can simulate its action. So as long as you put a lot of effort into getting a good simulator going, then you can carry on with the code you've had for 30, 40 years in some cases.
So sometimes your floppies would die, so you often would make backup copies. Let's try this one. Sounds more hopeful. And so there was this game called Lander, which became the full game Zarch. And when this game was released, it was sort of full 3D graphics.